Okay, I think we know enough now. We've got enough stuff in our bucket that we can start looking at groups. Eventually, we are getting there. It's not enough. We don't nearly have enough stuff in our bucket. We're going to add some more. We're going to revise what is inside of the bucket. But the bucket is full enough now that we can start looking at groups. By the way, green board, whiteboard gone. Now, the whiteboard, I mean, the whiteboard looks nice, but I find it awful to write on. I want this connection to something, and I get that connection by this resistance between the chalk and the chalkboard. I just love a chalkboard. Anyway, let's get to our definition of a group. What is a group? First of all, it is a set of elements. So I've got to have a few elements, and we won't go into depth now about Zermelo-Frankel set theory. Let's just imagine we have this set of elements. So let's just call it the set of elements. Set of elements. And the operation that we can apply between elements of that set. Now, in order for this set and its operation, so imagine the integers under addition or the integers under multiplication, a set of elements and the operation, I have to have the following property. First of all, there's got to be closure. In other words, if I take any two elements in that set, so imagine my group is this set G, and I take two elements, let's make it G1 and this operation, and let's make it GI and G sub J, so that's two elements in this group, and I apply the operation whatever I get from this operation must be an element of G. So the solution or the answer of taking two elements and this group, this operation on these elements, that solution must also be in G. So there's closure. The second one is there must be associativity. In other words, if I have this scenario where I have G, let's make it G1, and this operation G2, and the operation on G3, just three random elements from my group, that I have the following, that if I do these two first and then that has got to equal G1, and then G2 and G3. If I have that, I have associativity. That is different from commutativity. You can have commutativity, you can have groups that have commutativity, but it's not part of the definition here of a group. Number three is one of the elements must be the identity element. So one of these elements in G must be the identity element, so that if I take any random element in G and I have this element, one of those elements must be the identity element, and that gives me G, or E, G gives me G. I must have this property that one of these elements must be the identity element. And then lastly, we must have the inverse element. So there's one of them must also be the inverse element. In other words, if I have the inverse of G1, so that I have G1 and my operation and its inverse, that I must get the identity element, and the same has got to go for the inverse of that. And G1, that's also got to give me the identity element. So this wasn't that difficult, was it? If I have all of these things, I have the set of elements with an operation and it has these properties, then I have a group. And we can think of a group, let's just think about the integers under addition. Of course, I have closure. In other words, any two integers that I add to each other, the result will still be in there. I have associativity, and as much as 1 plus 2 is 3 plus 3, 6, and 2 plus 3 is 5, plus 1 is 6, you know, exactly the same thing. I have this identity element, which in this case is going to be 0, and for any element in that group A, I have the inverse, which is just the negative of A. So these integers under addition for me, for us, would be a group. And it seems so trivial, but it's actually so powerful.